Hi guys, thanks for joining me today. I'm Marilyn and my channel is Making with Marilyn. Now on today's video, we're going to sublimate a couple of kitchen towels. One of them I'll sublimate with some colors. One is just going to be black and white. I think this is going to be a quick, easy project, and even if you are a beginner, I think you can follow along with this and make some really cute projects. I'm going to start by showing you what I'll use today. Then I'll get on the computer, I'm going to find a couple of designs, I'll show you how I take them into my printing software, we'll print them, then we'll meet right back here. If you're interested in skipping any of those steps, then as I go along the way, I'll put some subtitles that tell you where to skip to for the next part. So let's start by looking at what we'll use. I'm going to use some HTV Rant sublimation paper. This is your standard 8.5 by 11 paper. I'm going to use a couple of sublimation towels. Now, I got these off of Amazon. They are that waffle weave texture. I've made a couple of these. I even have one that I use in my own kitchen, and they really are nice towels. They absorb very well. So I'm going to use a couple of these. Now, these are pretty large. These are 16 by 28. So as it hangs over, if you're like me, the oven door handle, it is 16 by 14. I've made them before where it takes the whole front, but on today's video, I'm going to use designs to where it's more like this. So in addition to my paper, my towels, I'm going to use this lint roller. I have a couple of pieces of butcher paper. We'll talk more about that later. I have some heat resistant tape. For my press, I'm going to use the HTV Rant Auto Press 2 that you see behind me. And for my printer, I'm going to use a converted Epson EcoTank. Now, all that means is instead of putting the ink in it that came with it, I put Hippo ink into it instead. It was a very easy process. I actually have a video on how to do that. I'll put a link to that in the video description below. I'll also put links to the towels and some other things that I'll use. For my designs, I'm going to find those on Creative Fabrica. Let's hop onto the computer. I'll show you that. Again, I'll show you how to print it, and I'll meet you right back here. The first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and open Creative Fabrica. Creative Fabrica is a website where you can buy designs or you can buy a year-long subscription where you download as many as you want at no additional cost. If you're interested in Creative Fabrica, I do have a link for a trial membership, or if you want to go ahead and buy a membership, I have a link for that as well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to click right here in the search bar, and I'm going to type in kitchen towel. And it came up with over 3,000 results. You have so many options with Creative Fabrica. When I first started using it, I thought I would only use it for my trial membership. I loved it, and now I just have continued to use it for a few years. I love it because I no longer have stress of trying to figure out where to find my designs. Now here's one of the designs that I want to use. Let's bake and watch Christmas movies. I just love that sentiment. Let's click here. And then I'm going to go ahead and say download. Now this has several files in it, but I'm going to use the one you see right here. So I'll click on download. Then to find my downloads on my Mac, I can either go right here or I can open up my Finder, go to downloads, and it's right here. Now, I don't want all of those on my desktop, so I'm going to go ahead and click on it, and I see it right here. I'm just going to drag that over to my desktop. Let's find my second design. So I'm going to go ahead and go back, and I'm still on the results for kitchen towel. And I like these sarcastic ones, and I really like this one right here. Annoying the cook will result in starvation. So I'm going to go ahead and click on that. Once again, I'll click download. But notice all these files that you get with this one download. So click on download. Again, I can go right here, or I go to my downloads, click on the folder. Oh my, there's so many. All right, let's just start with the first one. Okay, so in this file, you not only get a PNG, you also get an SVG, a JPEG, and a couple of other versions. In the last one that I downloaded, that was a PNG. I prefer SVGs. So I'll drag that one to my desktop as well. All right, let's go ahead and close out all of this. Now I'm going to print my designs in Inkscape. That is a free design software. It's what I started with because it was free. Since then, I've bought Silhouette Studio Business Edition and I use it a lot, but I want to show you a free version. So the first thing I want to do is I want to make sure that this is the correct size piece of paper. Whatever paper you are actually printing on is what you need to have here. So I'm going to go up to File, Document Properties, and this is actually size M4. Let me change this to inches. M4 is a little narrower than an 8.5 by 11 and a little taller. So I'll click on Format and I'll change that to 8.5 by 11. Once I clicked on that, it went ahead and changed it, and I can close this by clicking right here on the red X. Now, before I started this part of the video, I noticed that I actually downloaded the wrong design for my black and white. I downloaded one I didn't really want, so I did go ahead and add this one to my desktop as well. But we're going to start by printing the colored one. Drag it over. And then I just use the default settings and I say OK. With it selected, first of all, I'm going to change this to inches and I'm going to lock the proportions. And since I'm using 8.5 by 11 size paper, I'm going to change my height to 10.5. Okay, let me hit Shift and Plus to zoom in on this. Because there's some extra white space on this PNG, this is a PNG image, I can actually make it larger and take advantage of my whole piece of paper. So I'm going to change 10.5 to 11.5, and I'll show you what I mean. Because of all this extra white space, I can have it technically be 11.5, but because everything that I want printed, you can see on this piece of paper, it's going to print fine. Now, I think that's a little bit narrow. So let's hit the padlock to unlock the proportions, and then let's change this to 7.5. I think that still looks good. So I think I'll print it like that. Now, some people have their printers, their sublimation printer set to print in the mirrored image, because when you're doing sublimation, the vast majority of the time you mirror your image or you mirror your design. I don't do it that way. I just go up to Object and I say Flip Horizontal, and now I'm ready to print. So I can either hit Command P on my computer, or I can go up here and hit File, Print. I'm going to use an Epson EcoTank 15,000 series. That wasn't meant to be a sublimation printer, but I put Hippo ink in it instead of the ink that came with it. I'll go to Page Setup, and I change this to One-Sided. I go to Color, and I make sure it's going to print in color. Then I go to Advance, and I change it to High. That is all I do, and so I'm ready to click on Print. After deleting that first design, I took the second design into Inkscape the same way that I did the first design. First, I adjusted it to the size I wanted. After that, since it was an SVG, I was able to break apart the design and delete a couple of things that I didn't really like. Also, with it being an SVG, I could have changed the colors of parts of it, but I wanted it to be all black. Once I was happy with it, I grouped it back together, flipped it horizontally, and printed it. Today I'm using the HTV Auto Press 2. Now I already turned it on, and so it's going to be hotter than it usually would when you turn it on, but I didn't realize I wasn't filming when I turned it on. To turn it on, you press this power button right here.
I have mine preset to 385 degrees Fahrenheit for 55 seconds. Also, this new press does have pressure adjustments. You can go from 50 pounds of pressure to 170 pounds of pressure. I haven't used it on a towel yet, but I feel like in the middle is probably good. Also, I changed out my pad from the pad that comes with it to a true heat press pad. These are very dense, very thick, and I just think they give you better results, especially for things that need firm pressure, such as puff vinyl. You just pull the drawer out, and then I tend to work on mine from the side, so I'm actually standing right over here beside it. And this press comes out a great way. It comes out further than the original HTV Auto Press did. The drawer comes out farther, and that is a plus. Okay, let's go ahead and press this in. Now I'm just gonna press this for about 15 seconds. So we'll press it in, and then you press this little button right here since I don't have it to go down automatically. It lowers, and I like the fact that it lowers evenly or flat, unlike my clamshell that lowers in the back before the front. And unlike a swing away, it doesn't take a tremendous amount of space. All right, that's about 15 seconds. And actually that weave doesn't look too bad. It's not as fluffy as it started out, but it really isn't terrible. I can live with that. All right, let's go ahead and preheat or pre-press the second one. All right, let's move back over to the table, tape these down, and then we'll press them.
Now I went ahead and folded these over, and I see I got a little something on there. Let's go ahead and clean this off again. And I folded them down so that I would see from top to bottom what they'll look like when they're folded over my oven handle. Let's start with the one that has the various colors in it. When I am sublimating onto fabric, I like to tear around the design so that you don't get those harsh lines. Well, some people cut around them so that they at least don't have the rectangle harsh line, but when you cut around it, you're still going to have a little bit of an imprint. When you tear around it, the layers of the paper don't tear evenly, and so that harsh line is kind of hidden. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Hopefully you can see that there are layers to that paper, and sometimes the top layer will peel off and it'll leave less paper. So it kind of feathers out that harsh line. Go ahead and finish this one. We'll tape it down. And then we're gonna go ahead and get the second one ready. And then we'll be ready to go right back over to that press and press them on. Now I got really close to accidentally pulling off a little bit of that image. So be really careful. I like to sometimes put my finger down on it to keep that from happening. But I got really close right there. All right, here's the first one. And it's going to be a little bit hard to see through it to know that it's really centered exactly. We're going to do our best. So let me go ahead and figure out kind of where the center is. Now, I could measure and everything, but I'm going to eyeball this. It's going to be okay. But I definitely want it to be centered in the middle from left to right. And I think I'd like it down slightly from being centered from top to bottom. Okay. Now I can see the design through the paper, so that's going to help me. I think I'll take it to the right a little bit. And we will call that good. Now I want to go ahead and tape this down. And I want to tape it down for a couple of reasons. First of all, I'm going to be carrying this back over to the heat press, which really is just behind me. But it's going to want to shift if I don't. Second of all, when the press opens, whether it's a manual press or an auto press, when the press opens, sometimes it wants to lift the paper up. When the towel is so hot that it would still sublimate, if your paper shifts, that's when you can get the blurriness or the ghosting. And so putting tape on it, which I know I'm putting too much tape on it, that's just how I roll, but putting tape on it helps that from lifting and shifting. If you're using an auto press that's one of the heavy duty ones and they really pop open, you definitely want to use a decent amount of tape. So there's that one. Now my second one, it is so close to the edge of the paper that I'm probably not going to tear around the whole thing. But what I will do is tear these corners. Just like before, I want to go ahead and fold this from top to bottom so that I get my design placed correctly. Okay, let's flip it over. Again, I want it a little closer to the bottom of the towel than the top. And then, let's see, that looks pretty good. I am going to measure from the side of the towel to this little ribbon, that's 4 inches. And that, oh my goodness, that's 4 inches too. Perfect. I'm going to tape down here where I almost ripped that in just to hold it nice and secure. On this one, since it's pretty symmetrical, I'm going to get those 4 corners. And that's probably good enough, but I'm going to go ahead and do 2 more pieces.
Now I need to let my heat press heat up just a little bit more because when I was taping it down and I could hear this, I turned it off. But I can go ahead and get the first towel on here and ready. This is where the butcher paper comes into play. I don't want the ink to come through the backside of the paper like it does on some papers and ruin or transfer ink to the platen of my heat press. So to protect that from happening, I'll put a piece of butcher paper over it. All right, that has heated up all the way to 385. This is a very quiet press. Let's go ahead and push the drawer in. It has to click. And then I'm going to press the start button. Now, I realized that I should have put paper under this so that if the sublimation goes through the towel, it's not going to ruin the pad below it. Fortunately, I only had it under for a few seconds. And that did not happen, and I don't know if it's going to happen. We'll check and see. We'll see if any ink transfers to this piece of paper. But I've learned the hard way. Make sure you have something under what you're pressing so that it doesn't transfer to your heat pad. All right, let's start this over. I went the 55 seconds, and let's see, is there any ink on this paper? I don't see any. Let's see if there's any on that paper. I don't see any down there, so I can just reuse these, and I don't see a harsh line where my butcher paper was. Okay, let's just peel up one part of this. Let's peel up a part that you can actually see. And we're going to see how it transferred. Ooh, that looks pretty. That looks really pretty. I'll show you a close-up on the table. That looks really cute. Actually, I can show you a close-up right here. Look how pretty that is. That looks great. And I don't see the harsh lines from the butcher paper or from my sublimation paper. But you can see now, see the difference between how fluffy it is there and it's less fluffy here. But over time, that's going to come back. Okay, let's go ahead and put the second tail down. I'm going to make sure there's butcher paper under the design, even though it didn't go through last time. This is black ink, and there's a lot of black ink on this. And then because no ink transferred to this, I'm going to go ahead and reuse it. You can see it a little bit better there to see what I was talking about. I have my paper under it. I have my towel, then I have my sublimation paper, and then a protective sheet of butcher paper. So let's go ahead and press this in. Press to start, and we have 55 seconds until we're done. That is finished. Let's go ahead and check this out. I may want to increase the pressure just a little bit. Let me check it and see if I need to do that. Okay, so I can see where the waffle weave made it, where parts of it didn't press as well because of that texture. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to press it back down. I'm going to increase my pressure. I'm going to go from the 110 all the way up to the 170 pressure. I do see the black ink transferred onto this, so I'm going to get a new piece of butcher paper to cover over this. Printer paper was closer, so I just grabbed that instead. Now, I don't know that I want to go the full 55 seconds again. Most things will sublimate in 45 seconds, maybe even less. So I think I'll go ahead and lift this when there's about 10 seconds left. Now, here's my cover paper. It just stuck in there. All right. Take another look at this. And that did better. I can still see a slight variation, and that's just the nature of using this waffle weave towel. But it looks good. So let me take this to the table and I'll show you.
Now before I take this off, let's go ahead and look at the first towel. And I'll show you what I was talking about on the textural difference and how that affects the towels. That's gorgeous, super pretty, but especially in the black or dark gray, you see slight variations in the darkness. And that's because of the texture. It's not a flat surface, it's not a smooth surface, and so presses are going to have more pressure where the weave is up and less pressure where it's down. So whereas I said earlier that sublimating on fabric doesn't take an extreme amount of pressure, I probably would use heavy pressure on this. All right, so that was that one. Let's see how this turned out. Because this is flat black, those textural differences might show up slightly more in this, but it's gonna be fine. It still looks lovely. There it is. Super cute. Now the main place that I see the textural difference is in this end. So I'm going to show you the worst of it. And the worst of it's not terrible, but it's not perfect. I think it did a great job. I think that is really, really cute. And maybe it will keep people from annoying me while I'm cooking. So here's our final towels. One is sweet, one sassy. Which one is your favorite? I like them both, but I kind of lean toward this one. So So thank you so much for joining me today. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, give me that thumbs up. If you have any questions, comments, or suggestions, leave them in the comment section. And if you want the link to these towels, the press, the printer, the ink, check out the video description below. Those are typically affiliate links. When you use them, I do get a small referral fee that helps me with my channel, and I truly appreciate it. So thanks again for joining me, and until next time, bye-bye.